Well, in this final lecture in the series of talks on modern business, I want to take up the topic of leadership in particular and its relationship with management. Management and leadership in business, everybody understands, are very important. But what is not understood properly is how should we distinguish between management and leadership. For one, there is an increased focus on management of business. The clear distinction between management and leadership is management is something which is routine. Or more appropriately, if I have to put it, I would say that management is maintaining the business in a day-to-day manner. Whereas leadership is something which is special, which may not involve looking after the business in a day-to-day manner, but gives the overall direction to the business. Business requires management and leadership. Generally, it is assumed that management provides leadership, but it may not be the case. That is why, if you look at the history, we train managers. We don't train leaders. Somehow, I think everybody understands that we can train someone to become a manager, but not train someone to become a leader. Leadership is an intrinsic quality. You either have it or you don't. As simple as that. There has been an interest on leadership models from a long time. If you look at Greeks, they believed that leadership is a quality which runs through the genes, passes on from one generation to other. That is why the son of a king will become a king, kind of a concept. We also believed in here in India. But then after enlightenment and modern thinking, we decided that everybody can in fact become a leader. We accepted democracy. Whether it is right or wrong, we will not enter into a value discussion here. What is important for me today is take up certain models of leadership in my own way. And I will narrate a story picking up my favorite leaders from mythology, history and other places, giving my own view on what are the leadership models. Zimmerer discusses 9 different models of leadership. Some of which I do subscribe, many of it I would say is pure rubbish. For example, the modern theory of X leadership and Y leadership, I don't quite agree with the distinction of X leadership and Y leadership. Arindam Chaudhary had come up with the concept of I leadership, which he called Indian leadership. Partially I would agree, but not complete agreement. There is intrinsic, extrinsic view on leadership. There are views on democratic leadership and dictatorial leadership. There are different views on leadership. I would enter into this topic in a rather strange way. I would not look at the theory and then find the role model. I would find a role model and then discuss a theory which would fit that particular person. I think that method is a better method. So this is my personal account of what is leadership and how we should identify leadership. I will talk about 4 or 5 leaders who I think have demonstrated certain characteristics of leadership which we can clearly identify. My choice of leaders do not include politicians who are generally supposed to provide leadership. See, there are few aspects in human life where leadership role is defined. In politics, there is a place for a leader. Somebody has to fill it, that's all. I am not interested in that because there is a place for a leader. Similarly, in team sports, say cricket, there is a place for a leader. A team needs a captain. One has to fill that role, that's all. That do not hold any special interest for me because there is a place for a leader. My interest is in those leaders who created a place for themselves, who created a role, managed the role, and delivered what we expect from a leader. What do we expect from a leader? Modern definition of leader is someone who has followers. A group of people, if somebody is walking in front of that group, that person is called to be a leader. Leader should have followers. My idea is something different. My idea of a leader is someone who can inspire lots of people, not only through words but also through deeds. He is not a dreamer in a sense. He is not simply who has a vision of future, but who implements that vision. People who have simple visions, I will call them dreamers, not as visionaries. For me, leader is a one who has a vision, who knows the best method to implement it, and takes the believers along in that chosen path. He, for me, is a leader. I will identify a few people, some of whom you may agree, some of you may disagree. But this is purely my personal account. The first person whom I will take up in this discussion is an example of an exemplary leadership. Is Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. Now you may wonder why I consider Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as a first example of exemplary leader. Because of two, three reasons. One is, there is a great need in modern times for interreligious understanding, which is sorely missing in today's world. There is a section of people who have not read the text in original form, try to put Islam in a context, ridicule its followers, and try to paint Prophet in a very different robes. That's the reason why I have picked up Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, to analyze his role as a leader. I consider Prophet as a true example of a kind of leadership. I call it transformational leadership. Transformational leadership. The characteristic of a leader in this category is, he has a vision and he transforms the society in such a drastic way that the changed society will look so different than what it was before the leader came. Prophet did this. People argue that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, did so many wrong things. He reduced the status of women in the society. They quote from Quran, specifically chapter number 4, verse number 34 from Quran. What does it say? People interpret chapter 4, verse number 34 as the sanction from the God to look down upon women. Is it so? One has to read the text in original, interpret it in a right manner. The exact statement in chapter 4, verse number 34 reads like this. It says, women should be guarded always, either by the father or the brother or husband. And if she commits any mistake, she should be dealt in three ways. First, she should be warned. Next, she should be separated from her husband or guardian. Third, she should be beaten. I read in the newspapers today morning that a woman was beaten to death, and all the Muslim clerics said that this is supported in Quran. Again, quoting from Quran. The actual problem is, when somebody tries to understand other religion through the texts written in an alien language, They fault during translation. The exact word, if I recall it correctly, mentioned in Quran, does not have an equivalent word in English for the word. That is why the translated word was guardian. Islam, for everything what people say, should be understood in a right perspective. It was the first world religion which gave equal rights for women. It upheld their rights. There are various things which I can quote from Quran for my argument. Why that? The most sacred duty in the Muslim community, the calling for prayers, azar. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, chose a black slave named Bilal to give the first azan. It shows how much sense of equality Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, had during those medieval period when he had to invite a black slave to do the azan. The Middle East, where Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, started his preachings, the gospel of God, was in dark period, the time when Prophet entered into that region. How it transformed after that is for everyone to see. Islam today probably is the only religion which has kept all its practices intact, the discipline which they maintain is for everybody to see. If Prophet had said that on the one hand you carry the sword, that is because of a historical reason. Unfortunately, as it happens with every great leader, the preachings and the sayings which had a high value at a particular point of time was misinterpreted, misquoted, misapplied to other circumstances, thereby losing its value. I blame the ill-read Muslim clerics for this, not the holy book itself and not the Prophet himself. There is one more reason why I appreciate Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, more than any leader. According to me, he is the only leader who resisted the basic temptation of leadership. Today, any small leader who wants to be a leader, if he distributes 10 textbooks to people, he will have a huge poster of him hanging around in all the places. Remaining in the public memory is a curse which affects every leader. Every leader wants his name everywhere. Any small work done, he wants this work is done by this guy. Popularity, hero worship is something nobody can resist. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, resisted this. And how? He is the only leader who prohibited his followers from hero worshipping him. It's not an easy task. It's very easy to get into this. When you become popular, you want everybody to say Jai Jai. Islam has enough checks and balances within the religion to stop this thing from happening. Some people become fanatic resisting this. Anyway, that's a different story. But the practice of not allowing hero worship is really great. Allowing principles to prevail over personality does not come natural to leaders. Principles always take second seat, personality always dominates. This has not happened in Islam, and that's why I like that. So Prophet Muhammad should be our real role model of what and how a leader should be. transforming an entire creed, resisting temptation of popularity. Many people resist it personally, but then say, no, we can't do it because our followers want that. Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, resisted this also. There are enough quotes within Holy Quran which prevents people from doing this. Their basic prayer itself establishes only one God and their alliance only to the Supreme God and not to anyone else. Thus, not only making him above all these silly issues, but creating an environment where no silly leader can assume leadership, which has happened within many, many religions. For example, in Buddhism this happened. Buddha resisted personal worship. But what happened after Buddha died? His followers worship his fingernails, his hair, breaking all the basic principles which Buddha stood for. Why I like Islam is because they have resisted this basic temptation. It is the power of their idea. So let our first role model be Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, as an example of transformational leader. Very rare to find such a man. Following my journey in the realm of mythology, I pick my second hero. My second hero is also not a traditional choice. I pick up Lord Krishna as seen in the great epic war of Kurukshetra in Mahabharata as an example of a leader. Well, you may again wonder that Krishna did not have any role to play in the battle of Kurukshetra of Mahabharata, then why he should be considered as a leader? Here goes second characteristic of a leader according to me. You should understand the circumstance in which Krishna played a major role in the war of Kurukshetra. The battle is about to begin. Great warriors are standing face to face. And a great battle hero like Arjuna says, no, I will not fight. I will not fight for who is standing before me are my brothers and relatives. How am I supposed to fight them? He asks. This is a moral dilemma. You are in a battlefield and you are not ready to do your duty. There, Krishna exhibits one of the important characteristics of a leader. As a leader, he asks, Bhagavad Gita, chapter number 2, verse number 2 and 3. Kutastva kashmalamidam vishame sampastitam anarejushtam asvargyam akirtikaram. What is this you are doing here? This will not bring you any honor. This will not do any good to yourself. This will not bring you good name. Goes on, Klaibhyam Masmagama Partha. Leave all this and fight. Duty ethics, we say, is the most important ethic. Duty ethic. The soldier standing in the battlefront should not think about any other moral things. It is a duty to trigger, pull the trigger, do it. That is what Krishna said. It's your duty to do it. Why are you bothered? Goes on to explain all the philosophical things. Deinosminyata dehe komaram yavanam jara. All the philosophical things he goes on explaining, this guy does not listen. What follows is something very spectacular. Why I like Krishna as a leader is, there are three or four ways he explains to come out of this moral dilemma. First, he says, this is your duty. Do this. Karma Yoga. Next, he says, if you are so very worried about philosophical things, let me explain what this world is. Urdhva Moolam Midashakam. How is this world? He explains the nature of the world. Traigunya Vishaya. There are three types of issues. Goes on explaining every possible solution to the problem. That is not the greatest thing about Krishna. What is the greatest thing? Chapter number 18, he goes and finally he says, now that I have explained all the possible routes to solve your problem, yatha ichasi tatha kuru. You do what you want. This is again a quality of a leader. Seldom do we see leaders in history and in present times who give a choice to the followers. If somebody seeks advice from the leader, they say, you have to do this. Krishna does not say that. He leaves the decision to the seeker. He says, these are the possible ways. You decide what to do. Thereby accepting the fact that that guy who is seeking the advice is also a rational human being. He is not someone who does not have a mind of his own. He too can think. Respecting your followers is the lesson we should learn from Krishna. This is not something which leaders will get. Believe me. Leaders assume that they are in a moral high position. Followers are there. They have to advise. Followers have to follow blindly. Blind following is nothing but slavery. Does not speak good for a leader. Krishna showed this. That is why I chose Krishna as a leader. So if Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, is a leader for his transformational qualities, Lord Krishna is a leader for me because he showed how you should treat your followers. He says in Bhagavad Gita, you are my friend. This is what I have to tell you and this is what I should treat you. This quality of leadership we should appreciate. Moreover, that he motivated in the time of crisis. One more quality of a leader is to motivate during the time of crisis. Being a leader at a peace time is simple. Leadership comes during the time of crisis. How you handle the crisis? Exemplary way of leading, dealing with crisis was demonstrated by Krishna in the battlefield. We have to appreciate that. Whom do I choose next? I come to relatively present times to pick up my next leader. I choose not Gandhi ji as a sacred person, but Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi as an ordinary human being as my next leader. I have some differences with that man. Many people have. But that does not stop us from appreciating the fact that here was a man who came out of nowhere, assumed the leadership role of this country. This country was never a country before British came. Where was India? There was one Bundelkhand, there was one Madras province, there was Calcutta. Where was India? There was no sense of country here. Therefore, there was no question of national leadership. If you look at the history of freedom struggle, unfortunately, today's way of writing freedom struggle is there were British who were bad. These guys came, fought a struggle, they went out. It was not like that. It was a political struggle. One of the best things to happen during freedom struggle is unification of a country. India happened because of freedom struggle. All credit to that man, because see the history of freedom struggle till 1920s. Getting freedom was not easy. There were groups who believed in their own philosophy. Some people believed in extremist philosophy. Some people believed in political way of fighting it. There were various
proposed ways of getting freedom with no leader. What this guy came and did, he came and unified everyone. What I appreciate about that man, Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi, is the way he could inspire this many people in one go. Whether you like him or not like him, that man could inspire. People would say, yes, here is a man whom we can follow. Here is a man who can give us freedom. He had no place when he came. He created a place for him. Very tough in a country like India, wherein two people don't agree on how to make pickles. Two regions don't agree on anything. To bring all of them together and to make them believe that this guy can be a leader is not easy. Today, if I ask someone to name two or three national leaders today, very difficult. It is not easy to become a leader for an entire nation in this country which is so diverse and which inherently don't have a practice of remaining together. This man showed us how to be a leader in such a diverse environment. Today, when we talk about global leadership, in corporate environment, we talk about global leadership. When a multinational company which has branches in 100 countries, how should the CEO be? Is a question which plagues all these MNCs. He should be accepted throughout the world. Every employee should look up to the leader and say yes, in spite of all the cultural differences. I think the answer lies in guys like these who believed in simple philosophy, attacked the most common moral principles which everybody believes in, gave the purpose to the fight, led it successfully, but parted with pain. It happens with all leaders anyway. So I accept Mohandas Karamchand Gandhi as a leader for a basic nature of assuming leadership in such a hostile environment and then emerging as a true leader who can inspire millions. I cannot find a person who can stop the nation the way he would do, probably. So he is an exemplary leader for inspirational leadership. The next role model which I choose is a particularly well-known model of leadership. It's called emergent leadership. Leadership, we always say, should emerge from a situation. How do people show that they are leaders? They should not expect someone to bring the crown and put it on their head and say, yes, you are the leader now. That's not the way. They should assume leadership. If there is a situation, they should stand up and say, yes, I will take up the challenge. He is a leader. Indian cinema has exploited this to the core. You see any mainstream hero in Indian cinema, I am speaking about Indian cinema as in Hindi cinema and language cinema, what we traditionally call as mass movies. You see the standard formula of all these movies. Something will happen and suddenly the main person will say, yes, I will do this. Either taking revenge for the wrongdoings done on his sister or whoever. This guy always emerges. That formula is a standard formula in mainstream Indian movies. But there was one movie which created this unique character, which is a textbook case for how a leader should be. The character of Bhuvan in Lagaan. the movie Lagaan, what Ashutosh has done is painted a perfect example of emergence leadership. Whatever you want to say about emerging leader, you can find it there. Whether it is standing up to the occasion and taking up the challenge, in spite of knowing that this is a losing proposition, to building a team, finding out suitable partners, and finally going on and making a fairy tale ending. That movie had everything to say about emergent or emerging leadership. Go back and watch that movie scene by scene. Look at the way the character transforms from an ordinary villager to a strong leader who takes up challenge, believes that the challenge can be done, motivates, keeps the group together, goes to the fight, faces the odds, emerges as a winner. Standard template for a movie, nevertheless, but still a very good example. So my fourth choice for an emergent leadership is Bhuvan. There are many whom I want to name without going into details. I have broadly identified three or four kinds of leadership: transformational leadership, motivational leadership, inspirational leadership, and emergent leadership. I believe a leader can fit any one of these models. It is up to him to decide where he fits in. There are few people who I was thinking would make to the final list, but I left them in the midway. So I would like to briefly mention about them without going into much of the details. I thought in some way my ideal story, which had to be exploited by the Hindi cinema, but somehow they did not do, was the story of Imran Khan in 92 World Cup. The way Imran Khan led the team in the 92 World Cup was nothing short of a movie script. I remember he lifting the transparent glass World Cup with tears in his eyes and saying that he wants to start a cancer hospital in the name of the mother. So very clear, even today. 92 World Cup was a interesting story because Pakistan was simply no one when they came into the tournament. It was a time, if I recall correctly, Martin Crowe was leading the famed New Zealand team and Gooch was the captain of England. Kepler Wessels was the captain of South Africa. Richie Richardson was the captain of West Indies. All were good leaders. Experience. Kepler Wessels was, before Hansi Kroni took over the leadership from the South African team, they had just come out of the ban. And the way they were playing, the brand of cricket they were playing during those days and for a long time was something which should be appreciated. The spirit, unfortunately, they were the guys, all of us know, they lose on all unfortunate things happen to that team. But how Imran Khan moved his team in 92 World Cup was something which was, I'm still fascinated how that guy could do it. That was one guy who I thought should be a right example of how a leader should be. And I also like in parts, the way Indira Gandhi took this nation. For all the shortcomings she had, the soft corner for her son, the disregard to the rebels, everything apart, she showed how to run this country. Can you imagine moving this country into emergency today? Cannot. She had that guts We say today that just because she was the daughter of an influential leader, she could become prime minister. How many prime ministers did India have? Don't they have son and daughters? Have they come to politics and become so popular? Does anyone know the name of Lal Bahadur Shastri's son or daughter? They could have made it. She made it. And how? An illiterate villager also can recognize Indira Gandhi and speak of the policies which she came out with. You ask anyone in this country, old generation, they will say, what are the policies Indira Gandhi came out with? They will know Garibi Hatao. They will know land reforms. They will say this is due to Indira Gandhi. How many prime ministers have ruled this country who are known by their policies? She has. So we have to give due credit to her. But I am not considering all these people and many more, mainly because, as I have said, they had a place for leadership. So what do we learn? If you ask me, the bottom line is this. Be it business, be it life, all the leaders whom I have chosen had one thing in common. That is exemplary personal values. Nobody should even think and dream of becoming a leader if he is not of impeccable value. He should have that right sense of moral value. That is because speaking something which you don't have within you does not impress anyone. So, in business, if a manager wants to be considered as a leader, the first thing that he should do is he should demonstrate that behavior of leadership. Not because just by designation I am a team leader, let me order. Does not work. It does not work with a small group. It does not work with a nation. A leader is someone who should lead the way, have impeccable moral values, have strong vision for future, conviction to implement it. He will be leader. A business may have strong group of marketing ideas, good guys to look into the numbers in the financial sector, great sales force, excellent distribution system. To not survive if it does not have a strong leader. So, summarizing this long discussion of 50 odd hours, I just want to say that the whole aim of this course was to say to everyone, one, that business is not something which is limited to someone somewhere. You here can become businessmen, businesswomen. Anybody can get into business. It's not something very complex. It is not something which very few people understand. Anyone can become businessman, business person. And secondly, even if you don't want to be business person, this course should give you enough idea of what it takes to be an entrepreneur and how modern business run. That idea, if you have got it through this series of lectures, I think